things go wrong as they sometimes will, when the road you're trudging seems all uphill, when the funds are low and the debts are high, and you want to smile but you have to sigh, when care is pressing you down a bit, rest if you must, but don't you quit. Life is strange with its twists and turns, as every one of us sometimes learns, and many a failure comes about when he might have won had he stuck it out. So stick to the task though the pace seems slow. You may succeed with one more blow. Success is failure turned inside out, the silver tint of the clouds of doubt. And you never can tell how close you are. It may be close when it seems afar. So stick to the fight when your heart is hit. It's when things seem worse that you mustn't quit. Ah, poetry. This is something I memorized in high school, and it is a poem that comes rushing back to me often, particularly in those moments where I feel like I want to give up, I want to quit, things have gotten really difficult, and I just want to cash out. These words come screaming back to me. You know, we all got these quotes or passages from scripture or things that we have memorized in the past that bring us comfort in challenging seasons. I have a plethora of passages that I constantly want to keep at the forefront of my mind. I've got poems, I've got quotes from other people, and I'm sure you do as well. And we have these because the words of other people are powerful. And it's not only what they've said, it's oftentimes coupled with when they've said it. So, for example, in the midst of our challenging circumstances as a United States of America, speaking specifically to us Americans, we have woken up to the reality of how pervasive racism is in our country. And so when we think about Martin Luther King Jr. saying, "I have a dream," those words are powerful. But those words have taken on a deeper intensity for us as a nation right now in the midst of all that is unfolding. Words of others are powerful. And when we're in those precarious circumstances and seasons in our lives, we draw on the words of others. And this is precisely what is going on with the prophet Habakkuk. Now, Habakkuk is what we call a minor prophet, not because he was minor and other prophets were major. It's that his writing is relatively short. It's why we call it a minor prophetic book. And Habakkuk is living and doing his ministry at the very end of the 7th century BC, on the front end of the Babylonians coming in to take out the southern kingdom of Judah. The Babylonians are expanding their empire. They have come onto the world stage. They're ruling from the world's seat of power, if you will. And Habakkuk is speaking initially in his book to the situation that is going on in Judah. Now, Habakkuk is just 3 short chapters. And in fact, we didn't get chapters until the middle of the 16th century AD. And so when it comes to his work, it's not for us, it is for us chapters, but for him, it's organized around a complaint, a response, a complaint, a response, and then a prayer. And so the structure is really basic and it goes like this. Habakkuk has a complaint. And he looks on the circumstances of all of the injustice that is running rampant in the kingdom of Judah. And he goes before God and he says, "God, how can you put up with your people acting like this?" And God's response is, "Oh, I'm going to take care of that. I'm going to send in the Babylonians." And Habakkuk is like, "Whoa, whoa, 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 whoa." And so his complaint is then, "God, how in the world can you allow the Babylonians to punish us when the Babylonians are way worse than we are?" And then God's response is, "Don't worry about it, Habakkuk. I'm going to take care of the Babylonians as well. I'll punish them also." And then Habakkuk is like, "What is going on here?" Like, he is so unraveled by God's responses to his complaints that all he can do at the end of his book is compose a prayer. And friends, it is an astounding prayer of trust. He talks about how he doesn't understand what is going on, but he is going to trust God in the midst of these challenging circumstances. In fact, notice how his book ends. He says this in Habakkuk 3, 17 to 18, though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God, my Savior. And then here's the very last verse, the culminating moment for him in his prayer. He says, the sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to tread upon the heights. Now, the last part of this is actually a direct quote that he has borrowed from David, as in the guy that became king. Notice 2 Samuel 22, 33 to 34, David writes this. He says, it is God who arms me with strength and keeps my way secure. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He causes me to stand upon the heights. Now, here's what's cool about this is that if you go to the very first verse in 2 Samuel 22, you get the context for why David composed this in the first place. Notice how it reads. It says, David sang to the Lord the words of this song when the Lord delivered him from the hand of all his enemies and from the hand of Saul. And so David was on the run for his life. Saul was trying to kill him. It was a desert wilderness experience for David. Horrific circumstances. And yet God brought him through that. And as he is reflecting upon what unfolded, he says, God gave me strength. He kept my way secure. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He causes me to stand upon the heights. And just as David went through these awful circumstances and said, God gave me feet like the deer for it, Habakkuk says, oh, the sovereign Lord is my strength. He's building on that same theme of David. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to tread upon the heights. For Habakkuk, he's saying, I want David's experience to be my experience as well. And as we jump back into this Grapes in the Desert series, where we're talking about the wilderness, the desert, these hard seasons in our lives, and then we talk about finding grapes in the midst of the desert, which connects to a passage from Hosea 9:10, where God says, when I found Israel, it was like finding grapes in the desert. It's this imagery of a parched desert traveler stumbling upon the freakish discovery of grapes in the desert that gives life and vitality in the midst of the challenging circumstances. Friends, what Habakkuk is talking about, why he borrowed these words from David, I believe are significant for us to experience grapes in the desert. And it all begins not only with an understanding of why Habakkuk said what he said and that he was drawing upon David, but the imagery that David drew upon when he said, makes my feet like the feet of a deer, the thing that Habakkuk borrows from him. Now, he uses the word deer here. And for those of us in the Western world, the moment we hear deer, we think, oh, American white-tailed deer. That is not what David's experience was in the land of Israel. The deer that David was referring to is not this kind of a deer, but it looks more like this. It's technically a Nubian ibex. And this is a male ibex. You can tell because the horns are long and it's got a killer goatee. Come on now. That is a goatee. And the Nubian ibex are actually from the goat family, but they're often called deer, and that's how it got translated into our Bible. But the Nubian ibex reside in these steep desert landscapes where there are massive ravines and mountains, because this is where they thrive. And they are one of the most fascinating creatures on planet Earth. In fact, whenever the Discovery Channel or BBC or someone wants to capture the most incredible creatures on planet Earth, they typically go to En-Gedi. And En-Gedi, I'll show you a pic in a moment, is this desert oasis in the Judean wilderness. This is exactly where David was hiding out. In fact, we have a story in 1 Samuel 24 where he is hiding out in the caves in En-Gedi. And the Nubian ibex reside in the desert landscape, but they will come to En-Gedi because that's where the freshwater source is. And so you see here, this is a female, much smaller horns, if you will, and this is where they come to film the ibex. In fact, I want to show you one such clip captured in the BBC series Life on the Nubian Ibex. Let's watch this together.
But now the family must be on guard against predators. Or grab a chance to browse. Trailing behind, the last youngster is almost down and runs right into trouble. A fox. It's been waiting for a straggler. The kid has never seen a fox before, but knows it's in real peril. It appears to be running into more trouble as it heads back up the cliff. The fox tries to gain the higher ground. But the kid has found safety on a face so steep that only an ibex could stand there. The lessons learnt on this morning's descent have saved its life. Finally, the fox gives it up as a bad job. Perhaps suddenly aware it's standing on a precipice. Despite its tender age, the ibex has outwitted one of the canniest of predators.
Isn't that a great clip? Oh, what makes the ibex so astounding is that God has designed their cloven hoof, their feet, in such a way that the agility, the dexterity, the strength allows them to traverse the harshest of mountain faces, and they do it effortlessly. I mean, this female right here, if she slips 2 inches, she drops 1,000 feet to her death, and she will just nonchalantly walk across the cliff face because she has feet for the path. You see, life is all about paths, isn't it? And sometimes our paths lead to great places. Everything seems to be going well. You know, you get the promotion, you're healthy, your kids are thriving, work is going well, or school's going fantastic. You know, you get into the school that you want. Fill in the blank. But then there are other times, as we've been exploring in this series, where the path takes a very steep descent. And all of a sudden, you find yourself in these very hard and challenging situations. What do we do in those times? How, maybe you could say, can we pray in the midst of these circumstances? Because this is where this connects for me. This is where this has been one of the most helpful pieces of imagery and text that reminds me what I need to be praying in difficult times. Because I don't know about you, but when I get into difficult situations, my normal MO, the way that I respond, is that I ask God to change my path. You know, or somebody I know is going through a hard time, I'm like, God, just take away the disease, take away the cancer. God, fix this situation. God, provide the finances. You know, whatever it may be, my first impulse is to always ask God to change the path of the challenging landscape that I'm in or somebody else is in. And here's my question. Is that something we should be praying? I think unequivocally the answer is yes. We should always pray our heart's desire. We always pray for what we believe we need or want. I mean, even think about Jesus in Gethsemane. 3 times he asked God to take away the cup. He says, I don't want to go to the cross. I don't want to have to suffer this. 3 times he asked God to take this cup from him. So I don't think the issue is praying that our path would change. I think the bigger problem is that I think our prayers are incomplete. That in addition to praying our heart's desire, in praying what we want God to do, I believe that in order to fill out the prayer and being faithful to the scriptures, is that we also must pray for feet for the path. That when we say, God, I want you to do this, but if not, God, give me feet for the path. Because if God gives us feet like this Nubian ibex, then whether our path runs to the heights or to the depths, if we have the feet to traverse that path, we will be able to traverse that path. And so this is something that I want to encourage us to think about, especially if we're going through those challenging seasons of our lives. We're going through those desert experiences, is that we pray our heart's desire. But in addition to that, we pray feet for the path. And this is exactly what I pray for myself. This is what I pray for others. Dear God, do this, but if not, give them feet for the path. And oftentimes, even in my daily prayers, whether I'm experiencing a wilderness experience or not, I will often say, dear God, give me feet for the path. And as God gives us feet for the path, friends, I believe that that is grapes in the desert. That is something that when we know that we have the feet to traverse whatever is in front of us in the power of the Holy Spirit, you know, communally joined by one another, that we will be able to traverse the path. That gives us great courage and hope. And so Habakkuk says, the sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to tread upon the heights. So friends, as we close, I just want to show something to you. I reached out to my friend Todd Bolin, and Todd was the one who took this photo. He is the guy that runs BiblePlaces.com. And I said, hey, Todd, would you mind if I made this photo available to the entire Walking the Text community with the passage with your image overlaid with the passage and have a couple of different fonts so that they could download. And if they wanted to, you know, they could print it off and frame it like this or make it as, you know, the screensaver on your laptop or, you know, whatever you would want to use that for. And Todd says, absolutely. So at walkingthetext.com, underneath this particular teaching, you can download this image or the one with the other font, and you can use it as a way to be reminded that every single day we want God to give us feet for the path. And if we've got the feet like the Nubian ibex, then we will be able to tread upon the heights. Friends, thanks so much for watching. Thanks for listening, and may you walk out the text well in your life.